Welcome to this panel where we are discussing mental health in this pandemic and infodemic state of the world, especially with a focus on owners of small businesses. Today we have Nikhil Taneja, who leads Yuva, which is a content platform that works especially on mental health. We have Dr. Marcus Rane, who is the general manager of Thrive Global. And we have Prakriti Poddar, who is the managing trustee of the Poddar Foundation. So welcome everyone, and looking forward to, you know, knowing more from you in terms of what you're hearing from the field and your own experiences with, you know, mental health while we are in this crisis. So I just wanted to start with Nikhil. Nikhil, since you're an entrepreneur and fairly early in your entrepreneurial journey, how have the last 2 months been from a mental health perspective? Because, you know, it's almost like we have a personal crisis and a professional crisis. So why don't you talk about that? And also, what have you been hearing on your platform since your content is a lot focused on mental health?
Thank you, Prajita. First of all, really glad to be here among all these esteemed people. You know, it's a very important question that you've asked, because and if you would ask me this about a month and a half ago, I wouldn't have been able to answer. But now that I've had some time to think about it and process it, I have a little bit of an answer. And that being, you know, I think, first of all, it was quite remarkable to me how easily we shifted from work from home, work from office to work from home, right? That was like the first thing that happened when lockdown was announced. Almost all business owners found quick ways of shifting their companies and their businesses in whatever capacity that they possibly could to working from home. But unfortunately, in this time, we never allowed ourselves or our teams the time to process that this is not working from home. This is working in the middle of a crisis. This is not a summer vacation. This is not like a romantic thing that we are doing. Okay, let's all just quickly work from home and everything's going to be okay. This is a 2 month thing and then we'll come back and life will be normal. Life is probably going to be significantly different for the next 2 years perhaps. And none of us obviously knew that at that point of time. But more importantly, since there was no rule book or guidebook, and we could very easily mistake this for the human spirit, I also think that this is about the way we are conditioned under capitalism to kind of quickly first save our businesses, save our monies, without really giving ourselves or our teams time to process that, you know, suddenly we are finding ourselves in the middle of a once in a generation epidemic, you know, and a once in a generation crisis. So, I mean, I have gone through that myself. I think the first couple of weeks I had a lot of anxiety. I've been through clinical anxiety in the past, and my anxiety got immediately reactivated, not just because of the business and my employees, but also because some of my family does not stay. My parents don't stay in India, they stay abroad. And my brother stays again, not in this country. So I was very, very afraid of that. Having said that, I think it took me 3 to 4 weeks. I read this beautiful thing somewhere that kind of helped me process. Someone who has been in war-torn zones has wrote about the fact that while this is a lockdown that has happened to a lot of the countries for the first time, people who live in tough areas have gone through this over and over again. So they kind of put it out saying that forget the first 2 weeks. The first 2 weeks, you're not going to have any understanding of what's going on. You know, and just allow yourself those 2 weeks to kind of process things and then slowly try to get back on your feet. And that kind of really helped me, because I think week three, week four onwards, we have tried to make some sense of it. As a small business owner, I think the biggest challenge right now is, of course, how to protect my team, to make sure that we are not laying off people. If that means that we have to at some point do a few cuts in salary, but protect the larger team from, you know, protecting our numbers and protecting our employees. But more importantly, I also think it's very important to keep checking in on them and keep reminding them that, you know, they're not alone in what they're going through. We are all in this together. So that, again, this is not just about us making money and doing businesses, but also realizing that there are human beings that we work with. And it's very important for them to kind of understand that we care about them outside of just the money that they're earning for us. So yeah, it's been very challenging, to be honest. But yeah, I think we're all finding different ways of processing this. And I think that's the thing that I've learned more, that it's okay to kind of have our own unique way of looking at this. I'll talk a lot about what we are doing as a company and what we have learned about young people, but I think it's time to allow other people to talk. We'll come back to this.
Great. Thanks, Nikhil. And I mean, I can relate to this a lot because I also run a business and, you know, we've had our own anxieties. I'll actually jump to Dr. Marcus now. And, you know, if you could, you mentioned that you have a poll which actually has been keeping a track of how India is faring on mental health during the pandemic. So if you could talk us a little about the results from the poll, that would be great. And then we can go to Prakriti and see what she has learned from the field.
So, you know, at Thrive, our principal customer base is large corporations and their employees, etc., as we help them overcome behavioral change that they want to make. So from the period of the lockdown extension, we decided that it would be a right moment to keep an eye and keep a pulse as to what's going on within the communities that we're working with. So if we've roughly done this with about 2,500 people across 10 to 12 organizations now. The week starting the 13th, we saw an average stress and anxiety score of 6.1. But more worryingly is the number that was reporting extreme scores. So that's anything 8 and above. We had 28% of the population that responded in that category. The following week, so week 2 into the extension of lockdown, we've already seen that score go up. It's gone up to 6.8. So that's a 12% rise in just 1 week. But the extremist end of the spectrum has moved from 28% to 46%. It kind of maps in really nicely with what Nikhil was talking about. You know, there's this typical journey that people go through where the first bit is migration, adoption, engagement. Now we're beginning to get a sense in terms of that isolation and the data sort of correlates with that. In terms of the top three things that people are most anxious about, the highest category by far was job security. The uncertainty around work, Nikhil described it beautifully in terms of what entrepreneurs are going through. But of course, the employees within large corporations are feeling the same stresses and strains. Number two was their own sense of health and well-being. And number three was family, particularly children. So lots of young parents out there. I know we've got a couple in the panel as well. And so the challenges that are going on in their lives as well is very significant and will continue to do so as schools are likely to remain shut for many months, etc. So interesting for us to therefore see that there's a correlation between the data and what people are anecdotally talking about as well.
And I am wondering, is there also a split in terms of men and women? It's just a question if that is different for both genders.
So I don't have the data to suggest this bit.
Yeah. Okay, great. And Prakriti, over to you now in terms of what you have been hearing from people, and you said that you have a hand on the pulse of the nation. So what do you think about that?
So thank you for having me here, and it's always a pleasure to talk about mental health. One of the things that I love, which is the silver lining in this whole thing, is that mental health has become such an important topic, especially in India where it was a stigma before. Everybody's talking about mental health. There's webinars going on about mental health. We are running a complete helpline called Wellbeing Volunteers United. In our first year, I know that Nikhil used this word of the human spirit. In the first week, we had 600 volunteers join us. And that is the human spirit in life, you know, coming together to be able to uplift others. I think there's been no other time that we brought people together like this. I mean, that is one of the things that I want to recognize when we're talking about mental health. People are ready to aid others. People are ready to aid themselves. Because again, you know, talking about this, obviously the people that are calling in are people who are suffering. Are people who are suffering from a host of things. I mean, in fact, your question about are men and women suffering differently? Yes, they are suffering differently. They are both suffering equally, but they are suffering differently. And I think that is extremely important. And that is only because the gender roles still exist in our society. And it, no matter how much we try to hide it, it's never going to change, or at least it's not going to change for the near future. Because no matter how much we work, and we've had people who've called in because they do not have any time. They don't know the difference of when their work time has finished, when their home time has started. They don't know the difference between, you know, as primary caregivers, most of the primary caregivers are suffering. And as Marcus said, your kids are at home. I mean, I have 3 kids. He's got 2. We already know like how difficult it is having children. His are much younger. Ours are like school going children who need to focus. And you are still focusing on your job. So we understand, you know, what these people are going through. Intimate partner violence has gone up drastically. You hear about this, you read it constantly, but it is intimate partner violence is not just, I'm not even just talking about the violence that you're facing with your spouse, but also intimate terrorism, which you know, works with your family members and your children, whether that be the adults in your life, the sort of elderly, or it be the children in your life. There is a huge amount of stress on the on your entire situation, which causes it to erupt in different modes. I mean, being a therapist myself, one of the things that we've taught all the people who are working on our helpline is how do you help people identify the activating event, the behavior, and the outcome of this, as well as your consequences. We can't change the activating event. We can't change COVID-19. We can't change the consequence, especially in Mumbai. We're already up to June where we're going to be in lockdown. We can't change these things. So what is it that we can change? I mean, we know that in May, like by May 15, they projected. I know you like numbers. I'm just telling you numbers just for yourself. I don't really go by numbers. But 45,000 people are going to be sick in Mumbai just with the coronavirus in May. On the 15th, like around that time, this is what they projected. And this is not going to slow down until everybody pays huge amount of attention. I just finished a conference, like I said, a webinar. And we still have people saying, you know, this whole psychotic behavior of, you know, keeping yourself clean and washing your hands, don't you think is promoting OCD? Situational OCD is okay, because at this point you need to be really careful, because if you are careful, you are not going to spread it, because it's spread from surfaces as well. So you have to make sure that, so I mean, you buy something from, I mean, the pizza delivery guys, like 75 people got ill just with that. But if you buy something from outside, be rest assured that it needs to be sanitized before it comes into your house. I mean, yes, you have to be careful, and maybe you need to start focusing on changing the way in which you've been operating and not ordering stuff from outside if you can avoid it. And if you can not avoid it, make sure it's the necessities. Obviously, pizza is not a necessity, but it's a necessity that you can get. And obviously, talking about mental health and well-being, you know, we just spoke about so well-being 360, and you know, Marcus works with the well-being for corporates. Nikhil works with the well-being of the youth. But talking about well-being, I mean, people have to focus on self-care. You know, because self-care has five different aspects. And when you're talking about these five different aspects, mindset becomes the most important. So mental health is the most important. Then comes your physical fitness, your nutritional fitness, because if your mind is not there, if your mindset is not sort of focused on it, you're not going to be able to eat well. You're not going to be able to sleep well. You're not going to be able to do any kind of recovery, meditation, mindfulness. Those are all just words then. So how do you train that mindset? How do you make sure that mental health resilience is something that is focused on? And how do you get them to change the way in which they've been communicating with themselves to give themselves that priority to be able to take care of their well-being, so that these situations like of intimate partner violence or their inability to communicate with, so most people in relationships, for example, have been communicating on a functional level, but this is not a functional period. You cannot have functional communication. You need to have real conversations now. And it's almost like this lockdown has actually reinvited real conversation, has reinvited in families as well, with your children, with your spouse, with your parents, real conversation, which I find is such a great juxtaposition to what this isolation is supposed to do for us. You have to understand, human beings don't operate the way in which we are sort of technically meant to operate. It's physical distancing. Emotional distancing has really become the opposite. We have really tried to come together, like Nikhil was saying, and like I'm sure you have, or like Marcus says, we all have companies that we're running where it's actually run a little more effectively and efficiently, because not everybody's taking those coffee breaks like 24 times a day. You know, they actually are working on a dashboard and a strategy of what they have to give in. So I think this is going to really transform the way in which operations have been working. I think it's also going to help us understand that we don't need those swanky offices anymore, that, you know, a lot of work can be done like this and should be done like this. But what I find the most important thing when I talk about the finger on the pulse, even when I come to this, I find it interesting, and I say this like a lot, that this is really going to bring women on the same position as men, which wasn't happening before. Of course, you know, you said I run the National Women's Parliament, so I feel the same bit of that, right? It's going to bring us at par, because now everybody knows that you can be as effective even when you're working from the house. All you need to do is use your mindset, which means strategize, communicate openly, make sure you have a schedule in place follow that schedule, eat the right foods, drink the right nutrients that you need, make sure you spend time in recovery in your sleep, make sure you spend time. I mean, mindfulness and meditation is a great thing to say, but it's almost entitled because a lot of people don't have space. You know, you can't focus on that by not having space. You need space. Yes, you can have like I think there's a, what's it called? Calm and these other apps. You have these apps in place and maybe you can utilize that, but do you have the time? So really identifying what is your time in the day and focusing on that will really give this an identity. But on the pulse, people have increased their porn addiction. They've increased addiction for, I mean, I know that alcohol has become something that they can't get, but like spontaneous, like giving up of alcohol, spontaneous giving up of cigarettes, you know, these have mental health repercussions. And as you know, the internet has really, all the usage has really gone up, and you can tell why. And you can tell, like, there's a lot of struggle between parents and children because of the usage of their iPad or like the junk media time. And even adults, they're using junk. I mean, you're all like, I mean, it's just obviously a generalized statement, but I think people need to limit that junk time because whatever you put in is what you get out. Input equals output. So what you put in is what you're going to get out. So start using that methodology for like, or that time that you have for media that might help you or for social media that might help you, and not just junk media that's really going to get you no profits.
Great. I think Dr. Vikram, who's the co-founder of Sangat, has also joined us. So I'm just going to pull him in the conversation and then we'll come back, circle back to you. Dr. Vikram, hi.
Hi, is that Lena? Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, all right. I'm sorry, the internet's still not here, so I'm trying to connect on the phone. I don't know how long it'll last, but I just managed to join a few moments ago.
Okay, great. So Dr. Vikram, just before you joined, we were discussing, you know, what the mental health crisis has been during the pandemic with a specific focus on entrepreneurs, and Prakriti here was talking about what she has been hearing from the field in terms of, like, you know, people reaching out to her and how it's impacting men and women differently, and people who are primary caregivers versus people who are entrepreneurial roles or who are in jobs, etc. So we just wanted to get your first thoughts in terms of what do you think has been the impact of the pandemic, and what have you been hearing in terms of the mental health crisis that has come along with it?
Sure. So I hope you can hear me still because the line is just cutting in and out. Okay. So I, in many ways, I can't speak specifically about an audience of entrepreneurs. I don't know whether we really have that kind of granular information about the impact of mental health on specific groups in the population. So I can speak more generally. I think it's very clear that the infodemic, which is why I think part of the webinar's title, has been really, really greatly damaging to people's well-being. The information that we're getting is, first of all, completely inaccurate. It is presented very badly. It is impossible to interpret. From a scientist's point of view, it is actually meaningless. A bunch of numbers that come every day with actually no meaning attached to them. And what they really serve to do is to heighten anxiety. So that is one very important piece in the overall puzzle. The other big piece is uncertainty. Nobody really knows what's going to happen next week or even tomorrow. Every day we get different conflicting sets of rules. The latest one is right now about whether or not, things like hair salons can remain open or not. The utter lack of clear communication from our governments, both central and state, creates a huge amount of uncertainty. And I think the uncertainty is the greatest for people who are, I guess, small-scale business operators, because for them, the bottom line is threatened right now. And the extent to which it'll continue to remain threatened is a very, very great burden on your mental health. You know, worrying constantly about the future. And in this case, not just about an uncertain future, but also the fact that you have no control over it. But the one thing the human mind really needs is a sense of control over our own future. And right now what we're seeing on a mass scale is the complete removal of any sense of control that any one of us has on our own destinies. And I think that is also creating a huge amount of anxiety. Finally, This is a mass phenomenon. I don't think one should medicalize this. I think one should recognize that in any human context, if you have the circumstances that we have today of misinformation and the removal of all certainty in life, there will be a normative human reaction to that. And that is what we're seeing right now.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Vikram. And I am going to go back to Dr. Marcus. And, Dr. Vikram spoke about, you know, the uncertainty that is coming. And you also mentioned that people are scared about job security and, you know, possible pay cuts in the future. And has there also been, like, in your surveys, have you also seen this correlation with the infodemic and, you know, this the new regulations that keep coming every day? And I don't think that's only in India. It's actually happening everywhere around the world, because the governments are also functioning in very, like, you know, in very uncertain times. So do you see that there is a huge correlation with that? And what do you think as a content platform, for example, what do you recommend to people to, you know, save themselves from this infodemic? And as Prakriti also mentioned that, you know, if you're consuming that much junk, then you are going to have some mental health repercussions because of that as well. So what are you recommending? You also mentioned that you have some, frameworks around this.
So it's interesting to see how human consumption of information and content has been changing over the last few weeks. We've seen news site consumption double, so 100% up from where we were in February. We've seen music streaming go up by 67%. The online gaming has increased by half. And understandably, things like sports sites, etc., have gone down. Some of the data which came out of Bach just a few days ago was looking at people's consumption of movies and how that's sort of shifting towards more nostalgic, older type of films. Maybe for us to try and find a positive memory or a positive sense of emotional state amongst the uncertainty that we are currently living in. So that could be one thing. And I know the folks at Netflix have been pushing sort of older content that they've had as well. So, you know, there's a clear pattern in how we're consuming content, the type of content, etc. I think Prakriti said something really interesting about the fact that we should be focused on consuming positive, good things rather than focusing on the negative. And one sort of micro step that we often talk about is ensuring you have a news cutoff for the end of every day. So don't let news be the last thing that you consume before going to bed. Allow yourself 60, 90 minutes to have like a wind down period from there. So it's going to be interesting. I think Nikhil is doing a lot more in terms of the actual sort of content creation for young folks. So it'd be great to hear his input there as well.
Yeah, Nikhil, I was going to come to you. How are you as a content company, you know, addressing this, especially with young people?
There's a lot of stuff that we've had to do. And first of all, again, as a small business owner, I think we need to point out that a lot of businesses, even if they're online or offline, may need to pivot themselves in a way to create new business at this point. You know, because most of the business for companies in the media, in the media space comes from advertising or comes from, money that other brands are willing to put in. But at this point of time, given that no brand and no company really knows the future, as Dr. Vikram very rightly said, it's a very uncertain time for everyone. So we need to still find a way to kind of make ourselves more relevant at this point of time, because the relevance of the work that we will do, perhaps once we get through this and whenever that is, will keep us in the minds of people. So the most important thing for us has been to do relevant work. You know, how do we kind of make sure that the content that you're putting out at this point of time is relevant, not just to young people, but to anyone, who may come across our content. So at the same time, as Prakriti also pointed out, it's important to kind of keep the spirits of young people up. So we have been, broadly dividing our content into two spheres. One is a more positive, meme-worthy, relatable content that kind of keeps the spirit of young people up and kind of makes them realize not everything has to be as heavy, given the kind of news information that the infodemic, as we are calling it, that we are constantly consuming. And at the other hand, how do we kind of make sure that whatever they're consuming is relevant to them in different ways. For example, there's a lot of anxiety that a lot of young people now going to go through in different ways. You know, there are people who are staying away from their parents. There's people, and that's an anxious time for young people. There are young people who are staying with their parents, but don't really know how to kind of, they've not done this since their summer vacations, maybe multiple years ago. So now that's also being tough to deal with. There is obviously, you know, young people in long distance relationships. So those are tough times that they're going through. But most of all, career is a huge issue for them, right? Like, we don't know what is going to happen with the colleges. Some of them have exams in the final years. They're about to graduate. They don't know. Some of the offer letters that are given to young people are being rescinded. You know, so it's a very tough time for a lot of young people. And as I said before, and I think I spoke privately when we were talking at that time, where what is happening also is this is that young people are kind of looking at this as a time where they can fulfill a lot of the ambitions that they had in the past. You know, like, okay, we've suddenly got 3 months, 4 months. Let me complete all these courses that I wanted to do. Let me finally, make a play at being an influencer, and create new content. Let me learn a new dish. Let me do a course that I've never done before. But at the same time, you know, it is a crisis and it's not very easy to kind of focus on new things. So then you try and you fail, and that gives you even more anxiety that, am I doing this right? Or am I doing enough? And I constantly see that these are the two extremes that we are kind of grappling with. Am I doing too much? Am I doing too little? Can I do too much? Am I burning out? Am I consuming enough information? Am I not consuming enough information? So that's really the struggle. And we're trying to kind of find an empathetic, but at the same time, slightly more upbeat tone in our content so that we stay relevant to young people.
I'm glad, Nikhil, that you mentioned it, and I'm going to take this back to Prakriti. So, you know, there is almost this pressure of, there is almost this toxic productivity pressure on, you know, internet. And like, you see all these people who are doing cool things, who are learning new things, people who are, you know, trying to make the best out of the lockdown. And that may also increase anxiety for a lot of people, right? And you mentioned that what you actually need is time for yourself in the middle of all of this. And you mentioned that women especially struggle with that. And I can tell for sure that entrepreneurs struggle with that even in normal periods. So right now it's, that challenge has become even more huge. So how do you think that, you know, there is a flip, like there is a downside to this huge productivity pressure that we are inflicting upon ourselves during the pandemic? Or do you think that's a good coping mechanism? And if we are being able to productive, is there a, do we need to be more mindful about what it might be doing to other people?
Well, it's a great question, Aparajita, but I think there's a statement before this that you need to go to. What we're really talking about is any situation, anything that is happening has two or more ways of looking at it. So no matter what the situation or the activating event or the consequences, the belief system of how you are, who you are, and how you operate, and how, what your worldview is going to be different. So if somebody becomes proactive in this, should we blame that person for the folly of the other who looks at it as something negative? Or shall we curb it down and try to be this utilitarian type of person to make sure that, you know, we limit our own exposure to bring everybody on the same page? This is peer pressure. What you're talking about is peer pressure and the way in which peer pressure operates. If you have, unfortunately, the capability through your own framework and your frame of life, your vision, to taking it negatively, you will take it negatively. If you think that it's going to help you and mobilize you and make it something that you follow, as in there might be role models for you, you'll follow it. So there's no real formula for that. I mean, some people will look at, Nikhil knows this, I'm sure, but peer pressure has become such a big thing in terms of food disorders for women who are on Instagram, because they're also trying to keep up with the Joneses, as they say, or for the man who's looking at another person's company and the visibility that they have, and they're not able to do this. Of course, these are gender bias. Information that I'm giving you, but there is a generalized way of functioning, and this as I think one of the things that Dr. Vikram said as well makes sense. I mean, this is a game of snakes and ladders, back to square one. I mean, you can keep climbing up, and you know, snakes and ladders was actually a spiritual game. And it was to understand the way in which spirituality functions. And the fact is, yes, you do not have any control over life. What you do have control is in your internal locus of control. Those are the only things you have control over. So if you can manifest the best parts of yourself within your own internal locus of control, which is my thoughts, my belief, my action, my behavior, my understanding, then you are positioned for success. If you are not, if you have an outward locus of control where you think everybody else is doing this to you and your behavior is an outcome of somebody else's opinion, then yes, you are going to be miserable, or you are going to fall into that, you know, sort of negative spiral of feeling more vulnerable and more hopeless and helpless in your life. But that is why purpose come into play. That is why when you are feeling something that is obviously, you might not recognize the irrationality in it, but at least you'll be able to recognize the unhelpful or helpful parts in it. And if it's not helpful for you, this thought, and if it's not working for you, reach out to a therapist, because they're there to help you kind of formulate your new outlook, because you can't curb anybody else's behavior, and there will always be those rising stars and always those combustion of a neutron. You know, there will be. So you've got to understand that, you know, where do you lie in this? Where are your emotions? And who do you reach out to for help? And let me highlight here, since we are going to be promoting this outside of just this room, going to a therapist for something like this, or speaking to a therapist, is not... is not going to limit you, not going to embarrass you, not going to shame you, because there's no stigma in it. It just helps you like you would go to anybody. It helps you formulate a strategy for good living. So I think that's what we're talking about here. I mean, I can't blame anybody for social media for it. I think it's really your outlook, and reforming that outlook to a more helpful outlook to be able to aid you in your life is what this whole thing is.
Dr. Vikram, I'm going to come to you. So you said we don't need to medicalize this issue, but I think a lot of people struggle with that when do you start seeking medical help? Like, and is there a kind of a point at which you can recommend that, you know, people should look at, you know, therapy or reach out to somebody, a mental health professional?
So first of all, I think, you know, one has to see mental health as a dimension. There is no clear-cut point in that dimension where one can say one has a clinical condition like depression or anxiety, or one is just going through a really stressful time. There is no real sharp line between the two. But as a general rule of thumb, if you are feeling distressed for several weeks consistently, you're not able to pull yourself out of it, all the things that Prakriti described, if in spite of trying all those things, you're not able to actually start seeing things in a more positive way or a more balanced way. Because let's be honest, a positive way right now is also a little delusional, to be quite honest. You know, for many young people today, they're facing a future that has no jobs. Hi, can you hear me?
No, yeah.
Yes,
he can. Okay, sorry. So I think it's also important not to sort of, you know, deny the fact that the future is not that bright. One has to accept that. You know, one can't just wish it away with, you know, positive thinking. You know, for many of my students, for example, who are just finishing university after 4 years with massive debts, they're facing a total desert in the job market. Now, I can't wish that away with cognitive strategies. Let's think of the bright side. Let's meditate. Let's do whatever else you want to do. That reality is a real one. Okay, so I would say that it's more than just mind games. You know, there is a real need to recognize that there are enormous real threats to people's well-being and security. And I think what we need to do is to balance the mind games with an acceptance that these are realities that one has to. There's a wonderful kind of psychological model called acceptance and commitment, which is accept sometimes that there's a really there's a horrible thing that's happened that's outside your control that is affecting your life alongside the life of millions of others. And one has to learn to accept it, a little bit like losing someone you love. You can't, with any amount of mind game, change that. But what you have to do is to learn the art of accepting it psychologically and moving on and trying to make sense of what is completely an unexpected reality. Now, the final point I want to say is that if these problems continue, they persist, etc., in spite of all the things that you're trying, yes, then I think that would qualify. I think then you then have to look at evidence-based interventions. I think, you know, counseling is a catch-all world that captures everything from using, you know, I mean, it's a black box, you know, and I think I personally would say it's important for us to distinguish the kinds of mental health promotion and well-being interventions from those that are intended to help people with, frankly, clinically significant depression or anxiety recover from their illness. The latter is an illness, and it deserves the same degree of evidence-based approaches as, say, for example, treating COVID-19 does.
Great. And Dr. Marcus, I'm going to ask you to add on to it because I'm keen to hear the frameworks that I think you mentioned earlier in terms of people who are in leadership positions and how they could deal with mental health challenges as of now, and how could individuals help themselves during this period?
I think it's been well articulated by the other panelists, but just to, you know, officially give you the response, there are two areas that we encourage leaders to look at. One is leading self through this. And a lot of what Prakriti started off by talking about, which is basically the metaphor of putting your own oxygen mask on first before trying to help others, right? Everything from sleep upwards. So that element of self-care, addressing the opportunity within the crisis or reframing to a positive mindset. And then most importantly, and I think particularly for us at home with young kids, and a strong message for all the men out there is to lean in and share the load right now, particularly relevant in the cultural context in which we exist here in India and the lack of sort of norms that we would be accustomed to. So that's the first part. The second is sort of is leading others. So what do I as a leader need to do to help manage my team, my colleagues, etc.? The first thing is really to upregulate communication and express empathy. Those are two things which really need to be expressed right now, given the fact that we're not meeting each other physically because of the physical distancing. Number two as leaders is create micro moments of fun. Let's not forget that the office environment was just limited to work. We used to enjoy having lunch with someone, bumping into another individual serendipitously at the water cooler on the way to the washroom, etc. And in those moments, quite often, a lot of innovation and creativity and spark and just, you know, socialization used to happen. So we need to leverage the digital tools available to create those again. It could be a virtual coffee break. It could just be catching up with a colleague and not talk about work instead of just focusing on dashboards, etc. Number three, really important for leadership, is transparent and candid communication. Vikram spoke about this beautifully. You know, we do not have the answers. It is unlikely to be positive. And what teams want now, and actually we ran a survey, and 95% of employees actually want their leaders to give them weekly updates and communication. It doesn't need to be all positive, but they want to know what is that information which is coming through so that I feel satiated, at least in some degree of uncertainty around my business environment. And the last thing is for teams just to be there for one another. The role that we used to have in the old world may be less relevant today, but that doesn't mean we don't have the skills to help another member of the team whose role has suddenly become that much more interesting and important. So we need to adapt professionally as well as personally through this journey.
Great. And Nikhil, do you think that, you know, I love the phrase that Dr. Marcus used, that put the oxygen, mask on yourself first before giving it to others. Do you think entrepreneurs are being able to do a good job of that? And what are, and I think there's also this kind of dichotomy that I think a lot of entrepreneurs sometimes face and hesitate with in terms of maintaining transparency, but also not letting the panic flow down organization, because frankly, even entrepreneurs are in a very uncertain time and they may not have all the answers. So do you think that, what are the ways to deal with that? And have you thought about that?
Yeah, I mean, I've not just thought about it, I've also gone through it. So, right. some really important points made. I think leading self, something that we don't actually think of very often as entrepreneurs, right? Like, it's always first leading others. It's always like, let me look after my team. In many ways, you're also parenting. That's your first instinct, at least when you're empathetic to your team, right? You want to make sure that everyone else is doing well, they're protected. How can we make sure that the company is doing well? How can we make sure the business is okay before we actually really come down to ourselves and think about, how am I equipped enough at this point of time to face this? Do I understand everything that is that is necessary at this point of time for me to first grapple through this, accept this, that's been challenging for me to kind of go through. Again, as we spoke, I think this is unprecedented, right? Like, there are just no rule books for anything like this that has ever happened before. So where do you even look for inspiration. You know, you can't like pretty much go online and search, okay, what, how do kind of leaders or CEOs work in a crisis that is global and not just a company thing. But as I said, I think we're all learning, and I think that's very, very important for us to understand, each one of us, that at in this is not something that that we should feel bad about. You know, if we have a little bit of missteps at this point of time, because every one of us is learning every single day. You know, how do we kind of communicate? How do we behave? How do we try and acquaint ourselves to this new reality? How do we look at the new business, the market realities, and sort of communicate that to yourself, to the team? How do we pivot to new businesses? All of these are absolutely new things that are happening to us. And it's okay if we are not able to immediately sort of, you know, get into the best leader mode and make a few missteps. In fact, that's the communication I've had with my team very early on. I think within a week or 2 weeks, I realized I have so much anxiety. How am I going to, you know, be able to help everybody? So I put it out there and I said, listen, this is a very, very, very weird time, you know, and I will make some mistakes. Do forgive me for that. At the same time, I do hope that I can be there for you as well. And I think what Marcus again said about clear communication was something that was greatly appreciated. You know, it was me and two of our other senior members who kind of got together, sort of helped each other freak out a little bit, and then told the team, you know, that we are there for you. And but again, we don't have it sorted ourselves. So just allow us to kind of grapple with this first, and then we will help you through it as well. And I think that's a very, I mean, again, coming back to the same analogy, we should be wearing oxygen masks, but you know, it takes us time to kind of realize that, and that's okay.
And Nikhil, I'm just curious, are you able to have the same conversation with your clients?
One of the things that I've started doing is I've started asking, and while I of course always used to ask how are you to all the clients, I have started being a lot more meaningful in my how are yous, making sure I ask it twice if they say they are fine, because I want them to admit that they're not okay, because none of us are, right? Honestly. So let them also put it out there first and tell me that, you know, it has been tough, so that I can say, yes, I agree with you. It has been tough, and let's figure this out together, right? Because, you know, and I don't know, I don't want to be presumptuous, but I'm also realizing that, you know, the people that we talk to, right, even in big corporates and big brands, they're also going through this. You know, I think somewhere, a lot of companies may not be equipped enough to make space for people to process. So while I may, as a company that anyway focuses on mental health, talk to my employees and tell them, you know, let's make sure, I mean, every call, the first 15 minutes, we're just kind of checking in on each other. How are you feeling? How are you doing? I don't know how often that happens with, you know, brands that don't have mental health as a very big part of their communication or their ethos. And so I think it's also really a nice gesture to make sure that any client that you're kind of talking to, check with them, you know, are they doing okay? Allow them to also express themselves. And then sort of, but the moment we start realizing that we're in this together, things become easier.
Great. Thanks, Nikhil. I'm going to actually ask all the mental health professionals on this panel for some useful resources that, you know, small business owners, employees, anyone really, young people can use to get through this period. If we could start with Dr. Marcus, and then I'll come to Dr. Vikram and Prakriti.
Now, that's not a leading question you're asking me. Obviously, I would suggest that everyone check out thriveglobal.com or thriveglobal.in, etc. You know, content aside, what I really am trying to encourage people to think about is that this is a great opportunity to look inward. Quite often when I end my talks, I always say upward, onwards, and inwards, because, and it comes back to a point Prakriti made right at the beginning. You know, as we have been consumed in this whirlwind of content and media and uncertainty, etc., what we're forgetting is that there's an inner wisdom that resides in all of us. And if we can create a sense of calm and a quiet moment for ourselves, we could potentially find that sort of inner strength within that as well. So I would actually encourage folks not necessarily to look outside, but just, you know, take a moment and look inside.
Great. Prakriti, do you want to go next?
I mean, since this is a leading question, I think Wellbeing Volunteers United is really, you know, like I said, has come together to be able to help people in distress. And like, you know, all things that are to do with mental health, you have to recognize that there are five different types of telemental health. So you've got people who, you've got a helpline maybe, who'll give information about that. We have a distress line that will talk to you about the distress that you're facing. So really asking you, how are you doing, like how Nicole's doing. That is really what the helpline does. Of course, it escalates to clinical psychologists as well as to psychiatrists if needed, which is manned by Dr. Kersey. So we've got like about 10 psychiatrists who are there. So whatever needs to be escalated, if it comes to suicidal ideation, or if it comes to self-harm or harming others, or if it comes to clinical depression and disorders that have been medically claimed, we forward that straight away. But I think that this is a really good space to even just to help you get perspective, because it is a very difficult time and everybody is going through this. I mean, even companies have aligned with us because they want to talk about, you know, high governance, like what you guys are talking about. How do we manage that high governance standards, given the fact that we are a small organization, or people who are larger organizations are suffering because they are a consumer brand and there's every single person in the pipeline who works with them also begin to feel threatened, you know? So, how do they cope with this? We're talking about HR policies that have to be reformed. So when you're looking at, I think when people are looking at what really needs to be done from the point of view of corporate well-being as well, there's a lot of information out there, a lot of different companies that are doing well-being for corporates. And I think it's not about yoga and meditation, et cetera. It's really about the structure upon which you can build good practices given this time. And there is no certainty. I mean, we already know that every day it's just getting increased in terms of how much time we are going to be in lockdown. But like one of the keynotes of the well-being volunteers is that don't let the lockdown your mind and your emotions, right? Let's start, you know, working through that. And it's important. So it's a 1-800 number free of cost, and people can call that and have access to. Now, of course, we've added ration and all this kind of stuff as well, because there's some people who do not have the help. But really look at good media. So you've got a lot of webinars that are going out and people are really curating the kind of speakers that are coming on. I think that's really a good strategy to get some great advice. If you want to use that. But, you know, focus on giving yourself a curatorial list, like almost like how I think something that gives you this access to media that you want. Do that for yourself, because it's really important not to go into paradigms that might hurt you more.
Great. Dr. Vikram, do you have anything to add to that?
Not really. I mean, I think those are both great examples. I will say there are at least 20 or 30 such various, I mean, you know, I have never seen a more amazing mushrooming or flowering is a better word, of mental health initiatives in my lifetime. In fact, if anything, I think it's a little bewildering. I was just thinking the other day, the world is suffering soon from webinaritis soon. And I think if anything, it's too much now. The infodemic of the virus is now being replaced by the infodemic of mental health. And I think one has to be a little cautious about how many different initiatives have come up. And, you know, to be quite honest, and I don't speak for the two that we just heard about, without any real assurance of any quality in any of them. And I think that's the problem in part with mental health, is that it's you know, you wouldn't see this for COVID-19. You wouldn't have like a, you know, flourishing of different initiatives for, you know, middle class people, upper class people, lower class people on how you give ventilators. And I think this again speaks to my concern about mental health, is that it's treated like as if it's a kind of a, you know, that there's a kind of a slightly kind of fuzzy boundary about where does the kind of well-being industry end and the mental health care industry begin. Yeah, as I said, you would never have these conversations around respiratory support for COVID-19. And I think it's important for people to be well-informed of a full range, and that there in fact is a very fuzzy boundary between these two. A colleague of mine in Sangat has developed a resource of nearly 30 different initiatives in India, from both web-based and telephone-based, and also just simply other kind of information-based resources. So one thing for people to do when they don't really have a particular resource to go to is to just look at the whole range of things that are available, to go online, check them out, and you know, get some sense of confidence that actually this is the right solution for you. My worry, of course, is there's so much now happening. And as I said, you know, the information on any of them is incredibly shallow. As I said, if this was a medical situation, you would actually be very worried about people who are advertising without any real quality assurance. So I think quality is what worries me the most about most of these mental health initiatives. And it's important for people to really ask those questions before they actually engage with any service.
I think that's a really good point, because we have seen so many resources suddenly crop up and so many mental health experts also, you know, coming up, and nobody knows really where to go and who to consult with. So I think that's a really good point. I think any closing comments, anybody, and then we'll close this panel. Anything else that you'd like to add? Any of you? Yes, Nikhil.
I wanted to actually, first of all, again, Dr. Vikram has made such an important point. And I think a lot of companies need to be cognizant of this, that mental health cannot be treated as something that we just talk of because, you know, it's just lived experience. I think it's very important to make sure that we are constantly collaborating with psychologists, psychiatrists, and anybody who is, who has experience in treating this. At the same time, you know, I think what we've also realized among young people, and this is again coming from a lot of the initiatives we've done in the last 2 years, where, as you would know, we've gone for a roadshow across the country. We've been to 100 plus colleges. And what we have tried to create is safe spaces for young people to express themselves, which are, we call them baatcheet sessions, where we just kind of tell them that, you know, it's okay for you to talk about whatever you're going through without judgment. And that's all we want to provide. We just want to provide you a place for expression. And we are seeing that at this time also is probably a really important thing for for young people to be able to do, because we don't realize how important even the question, for example, how are you, becomes at a place at a time like this. You know, just checking in on people and kind of allowing them time to, you know, and we don't have to be experts in that way to kind of connect with each other by simple gestures and making sure that, you know, we are allowing people, acknowledging them and making them feel that they matter. Quickly, I also want to just add to one thing that we are doing as a company that I have found to be very helpful. So given that we work with young people and we are a company about young people, we have actually established something called a Yuva Think Tank, which is a bunch of young people that we have picked from different colleges that we have met, you know, and put them together and having Zoom meetings with them, asking them, what are you going through at this point of time? What do you want us to talk about? You know, and how can we help in this way? So we've got about 15 young people from different parts of India kind of helping us shape our content, shape our, messaging, and shape the way we look go forward. That's something that's really helped. And I would encourage anybody who kind of, if you can involve people who are relevant, your consumers or people who are relevant to your business at this point of time, ask them, reach out to them, ask them what they want and help and go forward in providing that. The second thing, and I really want to point this out, because I think we're in a very grateful position to have the support of Instagram, because we were doing offline Yuva Kindness Clubs earlier. We were trying to establish kindness clubs in separate colleges where young people can come through and express without judgment. We're now doing it online. Again, these are safe spaces for young people to just gather and express themselves. But we are making sure that we have psychologists also as part of these sessions, so that young people can express themselves and have experienced comments that come back to them. But sometimes I think we just need to acknowledge how important it is just to let out what you're going through. And if you're able to do that more often, even as business owners, even as people within companies or with young people or people at our homes, I think that can go in a long way at this point of time, just being able to express. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Nikhil. Is there anybody else who would like to kind of just add to that?
So I think just one point. I think there have been guidelines that have come out for teleconsultations and stuff. So I think that's a really good thing to adopt. It'll actually wean out a lot of the people who are not following the guidelines, and MCI as well as NIMHANS, I think, worked together on that, if I'm not mistaken. So I think that's a really good, so I think the government systems are getting more up to speed with what's really required. And in fact, we had this teleconference today with 30 of the top psychiatrists, and they're all going to be talking about tele mental health, which means, like I said, from information lines to teleconsultations to telecounseling and what the paradigms are in that, and how to involve yourself with really understanding what the guidelines are, what the safety and precautions are, and all that kind of stuff that goes along with it. So when it matures, I think when the system matures, people will really understand, like how Dr. Vikram said, I think people will really understand how to bifurcate well-being, mental health, and because the spectrum is so large, and anything aggravated will add and take it to the end of the spectrum. So really what the steps are in the middle. And I think, like Nikhil said, of course there's a space for people to communicate and just talk. And eventually, when you can escalate it, and when the rules and the guidelines are sorted, I think we can all, hopefully fit within those guidelines to be able to be successful in providing the services that we need in the best spectrum of mental health and well-being.
Thanks, Prakriti. I think that's really useful. And I think, thank you so much, everyone, for this great discussion. I think a few points stand out from this entire discussion. I think one big point that came out is the locus of control and how that needs to be inside, because as Dr. Vikram said, and Prakriti said, and Dr. Marcus said, that, you know, this is something that is affecting all of us. There's no place for this. And, you know, there needs to be a locus of control inside, especially given that we have so much information on the internet and all the time to access it now. So I think that is really useful. I think the second point that came in was also empathy. And I think that's more from perspective of, you know, how do you deal with employees? How do you deal with clients? How do you deal with family, everyone? And, you know, how we could help each other. I think the third really useful point that came out was actually resources, that, you know, there are a lot of resources available online, and it's been amazing how people have come together and the mental health community has really come together. But of course, as Dr. Vikram pointed out, that quality when it comes to so many things happening may be sacrificed, and we need to be mindful of how do we consume and access these services. But thankfully, as Prakriti has pointed out, there are guidelines that are coming out, and, you know, the government is jumping on this bandwagon, and they are realizing that there's a need to kind of regulate, or at least have some soft direction to these initiatives. And I think that will be really useful. So I think, thank you so much. I think this was really helpful, and thank you. I think I learned a lot specifically from this discussion.
Thank you so much.
Bye.
Thank you for having us.